After 2021's mind-blowing release of Apple M1 silicon, we're left a little bit underwhelmed with this year's nominal performance bump in the M2 Pro and M2 Max chipsets. Opening up, this new MacBook Pro reveals an almost identical machine to the previous model. Other than some changes in the logic board chip layout, we're looking at pretty much identical machines. But there is one major development for MacBook Pros that's worth mentioning. Several months after our initial teardown of the M1 Pro MacBook Pro, Apple did something remarkable. They published a comprehensive repair guide for this device, and I mean comprehensive. This thing is 162 pages long. For those of you that aren't aware, last year Apple launched its self-service repair program, which allowed people to get parts, tools, guides, and access to parts pairing directly from Apple. We did an entire video about the program and its pros and cons, so if you haven't seen that, make sure to check it out. Since these machines are so similar, we're unlikely to find any surprises with a regular teardown, so we thought we'd follow Apple's repair guide to see if their methodology is easy to understand and follow. Of course, there's no official guide for this M2 Pro MacBook Pro yet. We're filming on its release date, so we'll be using Apple's 14-inch M1 Pro MacBook Pro guide. They might not be a perfect fit, but I have a feeling they'll do just fine. And just looking through this, we've got 160 pages in this manual. A lot of it is the introduction, safety warnings, tools that are required, exploded view of the parts, which is awesome to have, part names and numbers, all the different types of screws that are used in this device, and there are a lot of them. The tools, a lot of tools that are listed here. We've got 3, 6, 9, 12, 24, 36, 39 different tools. We're going to run through this entire manual essentially because we're looking for the battery replacement, and because the battery replacement is sold as part of the bottom case for these units at the moment, it basically means we have to remove everything. We have to remove everything from the bottom case except for the battery. So we're gonna start there. Speaking of those 39 tools, we have most of those in our amazing ProTech toolkit. We're kind of missing a fire safe, and we're also missing the battery cover, which is the next step of this guide. So I guess we'll just skip over those, go straight to the trackpad cable and the battery management cable that we need to disconnect. The next component we're going to remove is the lid angle sensor, which is located in the top right corner of the device. Now, this component has a chip on it with a serial number, and as you might guess, it's paired with your logic board. That means you have to call into Apple, you have to give them the invoice number on which you ordered your replacement component, the serial number of the replacement component you received, and the serial number of your logic board. Now, what's super interesting about this component is this warning in the manual. Close the display when prompted while you run system configuration. If the display isn't fully closed during the process, you'll need to replace the lid angle sensor. Once you replace the lid angle sensor in your device, if your lid is open while you're running system configurator, which remember is a software process, then you're gonna burn this component. It's gonna be useless. You'll have to take it out, order another one, and put a new one in. So the trackpad and the flex cable are the next things to come out, and it's a little bit strange that they have you drape the laptop over the edge of the table. I'll go ahead and say it, I'm not a fan of this method for two reasons. One, you could accidentally drop the laptop, and two, you could put some pressure on that screen accidentally and break the screen or the hinge it rests on. I'm heading up to the vent antenna module next, and right about now I'm wishing I had that antenna tool. Our spudger disconnects the antenna cables easily enough, but that tool really does seem like it would make disconnecting and reconnecting these cables much safer and easier. With those cables disconnected, we've got a whopping 15 screws to remove to free the vent antenna module. The display is going to come off next, and to get started on that, we need to remove the hinge covers and the brackets securing the display cables to the logic board. Once these cables are disconnected, we're once again draping our machine over the edge of the table to remove the display hinge screws. With those screws out, the display swings back and lifts up and out of the case. So far, so good. The repair manual has been very comprehensive and very easy to follow. The only observation I had was that I wouldn't necessarily drape my screen over the edge of a table. That's personal preference. You can do it. It obviously works. It does seem that Apple has gone out of their way to make sure that you don't touch this battery, and that's very clear in the manual. Onto the logic board and all the brackets and screws covering the cables connected to it. The guide does a great job of labeling all the cables and highlighting what they are connected to. It's very helpful. So I just noticed that the logic board removal process is 23 pages long. Now, that makes me miss iFixit's guides that provide repair time and repair difficulties right at the beginning of each guide. So the logic board removal process is indeed a long one. Tons of screws and cables. But this guide actually does a really good job walking you through things. It even has some handy tips like using Kapton tape to secure the fan flex cables before lifting the board out. The audio board and fans come out next, and both processes are very straightforward. I do like the callout in Apple's guide about the various size T3 screws. Even though these screws use the same bit driver, their lengths are different, and this is an extremely important thing to be aware of. The MagSafe 3 port and the Touch ID board are the next things to come out, and there's something really interesting about the Touch ID reassembly steps. You can get a sense for the Apple brand perfectionism with the alignment tools that come with the trackpad and the Touch ID buttons, which are paper thin. It's not good enough to just replace a component, it also has to sit perfectly within the chassis. It's an admirable attention to detail. Now we're just left with the battery and top case, and that's where this guide stops. The battery does have adhesive strips to remove it, but once again, Apple's fear of even touching the battery may make you think you can't replace it without replacing the entire top case. We've also got yet another instance of requiring Apple's system configuration tools to complete a battery replacement. Way too many software locks here. So with everything out, how did the M2 Pro MacBook Pro score on our repairability scale? It got a tentative 5 out of 10, with the assumption that official repair guides will be posted in the future. iFixit came into existence 20 years ago precisely because Apple wouldn't release their repair manuals to the general public. It's pretty cool that they're doing that now, albeit with a lot of pressure from repair advocacy groups, which has led to the wave of legislative action that we're now seeing across the globe. While these devices are more repairable because of the availability of service manuals, the threat of parts pairing means that we're still locked into Apple's ecosystem. The lack of third-party spare parts leaves our devices vulnerable to the threat of planned obsolescence, because sooner or later, Apple will drop support for our devices, and with software locks in place, we won't have the option of repairing our devices that no longer have hardware or software support from the manufacturer.